Now I want to welcome Paul Murray, who is Vice President of Sustainability and Environmental Affairs at Shaw Industries. Paul joined Shaw in 2011 after more than 22 years at Herman Miller. The Environmental Quality Action Team that Paul helped establish led Herman Miller to high profile recognition as an environmentally progressive company, including a presidential citation and national recognition. He was recently named a finalist in the 2016 International Circular Awards. He was an inaugural inductee into the West Michigan Sustainable Business Hall of Fame. You can read more about Paul in the program that you have. And so now I would like to invite him up here to share with us his experiences.
Thank you very much. It's great to be home. You know, after 23 years, Michigan became my home, and all of a sudden we were transplanted into this strange world of the South, where in the local newspaper they still have this day in the war, and they share what happened in the war of the Civil War. So I'm truly a carpetbagger. I'm working for a carpet company, and I get referred to that once in a while. But it's been a fun transition. I don't have to shovel snow. I stay home if it snows, in fact. But it's been great to come home and see all these, the legacy, all your friends that are here that, you know, way back when. I'm going to give you just a little bit of history of myself, is that Bob Johnson and I were having a conversation on a run back in 1988, and I founded the Environmental Quality Action Team at Herman Miller. And so, Bob, thanks for that. You know, that was a great friend. We got a lot started, and along comes the West Michigan Environmental Action Council, and they invite us all to a meeting. There was probably 10, 15 companies, and they said, you know, we got this idea to get businesses together, and so we stopped fighting. And West Michigan Environmental Action Council, of course, founded the Sustainable Business Forum. And so it's great to come back and see an audience like this happening yet. I mean, it's been 20-some years that we've been in existence, right? 23 or 24, the West Michigan Environmental Action, the Sustainable Business Forum. So it's great to be home. But you're here to hear a little bit about what I'm doing. Dan asked me to come back, and he said, just talk about what you've been working on a little bit at Shaw. And so I'd like to kick off and show you what Shaw is, if you don't know. Great, great company, great products. If you don't know, Shaw Industries is a flooring manufacturer. We manufacture everything from turf all the way to residential and commercial carpet tile, hard surfaces, ceramic tile, vinyl flooring. Yes, we kind of make it all. We're actually number two, but we're trying harder. We are number two to Mohawk, but we're number one in carpet sales. So every week we send out about 10 million square yards of carpet. We have plants that put out a whole semi-load every 20 minutes. And the interesting thing about the company that was a difference from Herman Miller is that we are vertically integrated, which means we start with a clear liquid about the color of that water, and it's called caprolactam, and we make our own nylon that make the filament to make the thread, to make the yarn, to make the carpet, and we do the same thing for backing and everything involved. So we are vertically integrated. So we have about 26 or 27,000 employees in 54 manufacturing facilities in Northwest Georgia, mostly, which is kind of crazy. I left Michigan, you know, office furniture, right? Everybody's together. Everybody's together in carpet in Dalton, Georgia. Go figure. It's kind of interesting, though, is because of some equipment was actually made in Chattanooga, Tennessee, and we're about 40 miles south of Chattanooga, and we had water. And that's how the carpet industry started in our area. And it's interesting, water still continues to be a very plentiful, except in drought. And we've had two since I've been down there. So again, climate change is making an effect, so we do talk about and worry about that kind of thing. So, again, about a $5 billion company, and the biggest change is I went to work for a company that's owned by Warren Buffett. We have no debt. That's a little different than Herman Miller or the Steelcases or the publicly traded companies. Nobody knows much about our financials because we're so small. We're only $5 billion that we're not material to Warren Buffett's annual report, so nobody can see anything about us. It's kind of nice. We get hidden a little bit. Well, what I'm going to talk about then is already talked a little bit about Shaw Industries, and again, if you have questions, you know, we can cover those as well. But current topics is the circular economy, and that's, you know, I got nominated for that award, and Ellen MacArthur Foundation started this thing, started talking about the circular economy and what is that. And it's gaining momentum. A lot of our customers are asking. Not so much on the residential side, and I'll talk more about that as I go through. Residential mom, when she walks into Home Depot, really isn't paying attention to sustainability. But on a commercial side, we do have customers asking about the circular economy and cradle-to-cradle and these type of things. And by the way, that isn't sexist that I said mom. Because guys, I'm afraid that when it comes to carpet buying, it is mom making the decision like 99% of the time, and we just, as they say, sign a check. That through statistics is actually something that I can honestly say. And so anyway, circular economy, some issues to resolve, and EPR, talking about cradle to cradle. And then the last topic I'll talk about is what we call transparency. Our customers are starting to ask for what's in your product. And that is even coming into the residential market, and we'll talk a little bit about that. So we're more than a flooring company, 20,000 employees. And so it's a little bit different scale than I had before. And you know, I had a plan that I was gonna go see every facility. Been there 6 years, been to about a half. You know, it's hard to get to every one of those facilities, even though we're kind of in a general area. We're a company that has grown up through acquisition. And so a lot of times I don't have to go to every facility to see exactly the same thing. In Dalton, Georgia, at one point, there were 400 carpet manufacturers in Dalton, Georgia. Dalton's not as big as, probably put Muskegon and Holland together, that'd be our population, right? And you have 400 companies, now there are three. And so we have plants right across the street from each other making exactly the same carpet. You know, so you go into one, you've seen the other. And so it really is an interesting company. If you ever come to Dalton, Georgia, make sure you go to Barnes of the Garden where this picture's taken. It's a pre-Civil War mansion that you can take some stunning pictures. It's called Barnes of the Garden. You can also play a good round of golf. So what's Shaw about? If you look up there, our vision is to create a better future. That's why the first slide. And if you'd have heard the video, it's really about what our CEO sees as our mission in life is to create a better future. And as a commodity manufacturer, and carpet is kind of considered commodity with the exception of the commercial carpet, that is a little bit more expensive. But on the residential side, it really is a commodity. What's price? You got to compete with price and durability and beauty, and then maybe sustainability. So how do you create a better future is what I was hired to do. And so I'm continually trying to get into that journey, and how do we do it in our communities? How do we do it with our employees? And how do we do it with our customers? Business strategy is the most interesting decision or discussion I've ever had. Called my CEO the night before a steering committee, much like what we had at Equat, except it's all the top 20 people in the company. We were getting together once every twice a year. And after about 2 years, I thought to myself, you know what? I've never asked Vance to tell that group what he thought sustainability is. And he stood up, and for 40 minutes, he talked about those four bullet points. The CEO of a major corporation be able to articulate to his peers, his employees, that we should take care of the planet, protect and use resources efficiently, but also take care of people and take care of the bottom line, triple bottom line, right? And then finally, drive innovation, the top one there, drive innovation, make change happen. And actually, I've got a team here this week meeting with Steelcase and Herman Miller talking about innovation, because we want to change what we're currently doing. So he made that comment. I immediately immortalized it and called it the sustainable business strategy. And that went for about 2 years where that was communicated. If you look in our annual report, you'll see it. And then this last year, he said, hold it. That's not our sustainability business strategy. That is our business strategy. And so every employee is now schooled that this is what they're supposed to be paying attention to. It makes a difference. Okay, Vance Bell is his name. Replaced Bob Shaw, who had founded the company. And if we have time, I'll go into that. But Bob is still doing well. So anyway, here's just a few statistics about the company. We have 116 manufacturing distribution centers, of which we have built less than half. The distribution centers, we have built about, so it's about a quarter actually. In manufacturing, we've only built three of them. All kinds of customer deliveries every day, 100 million pounds of carpet recycled annually, and $5 billion in sales. So that's kind of the high level. Here are some brands that you might recognize, but about half the time, if you walk into a carpet shop, you might not even see Shaw on the label. We do a lot of private labeling. So like the Martha Stewart collection, well, that's Martha Stewart's, but it's actually us making it. Home Depot, you walk in, and it's hard to find our name. We make half of our carpet. We make half of Lowe's. We make half of basically everybody's. Okay, so there is nothing circular about the circular economy. This is actually some fun I had. I got asked to speak at Georgia Tech recently, and so I went down to Atlanta and met with some master students, and they were all excited about hearing about the circular economy, and that was what I was supposed to talk about, so that was my slide. And these poor master students didn't know what hit them. They went, "What? What are you talking about? Nothing circular about the circular economy. It's such an easy topic." And sure, right? A circle. Equal distance from one point. Pretty easy definition, right? We all studied it in geometry and math. Circular economy. So this is the whole economy. How do you bring things all the way through and bring it back? So, you know, design, production, delivery, use by customer, and then collection of reuse. Well, I went to this conference out in California, and I heard a lot of good things from Ellen and her team. And they were talking about this whole concept, make sure that everything can be designed and taken back. And I'm wrestling with it a bit because, quite frankly, since joining Shaw, 100 million pounds of recycling sounds like a lot, right? Well, we generate, if it's 10 million a year, it's 4 billion pounds that we produce. So that's a lot of pounds. So percentage-wise, we're not doing that well. So I'm struggling with the circular economy a little bit. And I'm talking to my son. And this very intellectual person was listening. And she said, "Papa, I'll draw you a circle." She was doing a half at the time. And I looked at it and I said, "That's exactly the circular economy. There is nothing neat and nice like a circle with this." And it's absolutely true. And she's so proud of that I use her. So let's talk about carpet for just a minute. So this is just our soft surface side of the business. A carpet is made up of three layers, the bottom, middle, and top. The middle is what you tuft the yarns into. That's what you saw the needles going. Now realize that when you make carpet, it's usually between 8 and 12 needles per inch. So in a 12-foot width, you can do the math. That's a lot of needles, a lot of bundles of yarn, all feeding in here. It's tufted in there. Visually stunning to see our plants do that, high-speed capacity. But then you have to glue it so it doesn't pull out of that web. And then you put a backing on it so it definitely has some rigidity so when your person is stretching it into your house, it doesn't stretch apart. Now, the problem is the middle layer on the residential carpet is latex. Latex is expensive. So over the years, you know, people hated it when you'd grab a piece of yarn. I can remember this, I'm old enough. Grab a piece of yarn and pull it and you'd run the whole room. Mom hated it. Our first carpet we had, our dog would do it. It'd get it started, and just like that, you'd have a run going through the whole length. So people hated that, so they figured out, let's use some good glue to stick it to that primary. That good glue is extended then with calcium carbonate, dirt. So now you have a conglomeration of polymer, plastics, with an adhesive mixed with dirt. How do you separate that? To make it new again at the end is tough. Compare that to our commercial carpet, not this, but you'll see the carpet tiles that you see in office spaces. That has a very thick polymer layer. That's worth money. That I can get back, I can grind up because there's so much polymer and just put it back in the new. So that's easy. The unfortunate thing is we sell 1/3 of that to 2/3 of this. So this is where my problem lies. So let's talk then about our circular economy model. This is a diagram that our head of communications put together, and it depicts it pretty well. I'm going to talk about a couple of these topics, but in general, we design it, we manufacture it, we deliver it, make sure we take care of the market. 66% of all of our sales today are cradle-to-cradle certified, regardless of what it is. By the way, I'll give you a little hint. There'll be a news announcement very shortly that this is going to go to 80, about 85% of all of our sales are cradle-to-cradle certified. We deliver it, we use it, you take it back, and then what do you do with it? So my role is to pay attention to all three. So let's talk about design. When you're designing a product and you say to the customer, will you pay more? And the answer is a resounding no on the commercial place. We've had a couple tries at it. Our competitors have. Make it all out of one polymer, right? So you could just grind it up and use it. To do that, because you're not extending the adhesive, all of a sudden the price goes up. But it is growing. People are actually starting to pay attention to it and ask us more often. So if I can do anything, get you to ask questions, that's what we need you to do, to send the market to talk to your carpet salesperson, say, you know what, I'd really like to have sustainable. I'd like to have one polymer type. That doesn't happen very often. Again, why aren't I talking about circular economy? When I talk about the raw materials here, as we go into manufacturing, you have post-industrial and post-consumer content. We recycle about 90 million pounds within Shaw. Last year we recycled outside and sold to the outside about $10 million worth of recycled content. So it's pretty good. So we use it mostly inside the company. Well, the reason I say though that the circular economy is not circular is that about roughly residential now in the market, all the numbers are pointing to about 50% of all carpets made out of polyester. We have always been known as a nylon house. Again, we take the white liquid, make it's called caprolactam from a distillery. We make our yarn from it, and we make the product. Well, along comes Bob Shaw. He retires, and he decides he is only 86 years old, so he's not done yet. So he starts another carpet company called EF Flooring. And EF Flooring specializes in polyester and forces us all to start making more polyester because it's cheaper, right? Because the customer's demanding polyester. So what we reached out and did is we signed an agreement with a company called DAC. And DAC and us, it's a cooperative 50-50. And we take back old soda bottles. So Michigan, the 10-cent rule, thank you very much, because you're the raw materials for our product. I know that for a fact. We make about 140 million pounds of polyester yarn from soda bottles. So without us, Coca-Cola and Pepsi would be struggling. Mohawk, it's about the same number. Both of us are using well over 100 million pounds. That's 4 billion bottles for us last year that we recycled back into yarn. So how can I say that's a circle when it's somebody else's industry that we're helping? That's the real story here. That's what the circular economy and what I'm helping drive at the circular economy is trying to get us to understand that it's more a spiral. It's more reach out and fit and use and dictate how people use these materials based on where's the material best suited. For an example, when we recycle polyester or nylon and it's already been contaminated with this dirt, it doesn't make real pretty plastic. But underneath the hood of a car, you don't know it. But some of your cars are currently being made with parts from carpet because we sell that engineered plastic, it's called, into that marketplace, and nylon makes great underhood because it's temperature resistant, polyester, not so much, it's a little bit too pliable. But we find markets that want to use our materials, so we also always look for recycled content. So calcium carbonate that we use is a recycled content. Glass that we use in our commercial carpet, there's some fiberglass in there for reinforcement. That comes from recycled auto glass. So on down the line, when we look for raw materials, we're looking constantly for recycled materials because virgin is not always great to use. It sometimes gets really expensive. And in fact, just recently, I'll jump ahead a little bit. I'm really active in the Carpet Recycling of America effort. It's called CARE, and I'm on the board of that. CARE is a conglomeration just like BIFMA, right? It is the equivalent of a BIFMA type exercise. And we need to cooperate and find homes for this carpet because most people don't want to use it. And So I'm talking to my boss recently, and I said, you know what, Hal, and Hal Long, this guy that hired me, just recently retired, but I said, Hal, you know what we really need is the price of oil to go up. And he looked at me, he goes, you're out of your ever-loving mind. And that's the problem that you are when you're a sustainability guy, right? You can be recognized as the tree hugger that would want our fuel prices to go up. Well, of course, it would hurt us a lot more than what recycling and the lack of ability to recycle would help us, right? So you do have to kind of play that game and try to find the right places for recycled plastics to be used. Virgin raw materials, again, even there, part of my role is making sure that we have a sustainable sourcing guide that we have released, and all of our suppliers sign it. They're forced to sign it if they want to sell stuff to us. Luckily, we're large enough. In most cases, we get by with it. There are sometimes they push back at us and say, you're not big enough. And so then we have those negotiations. That's no different when I was at Herman Miller either, is that there was really a pushback anytime you talk to suppliers and say, give me your formula, give me your information. But if you risk not asking those questions of your suppliers, you actually risk your reputation. And so when people say, Paul, how can we afford to do that? We talk about risk many times. If you talk about it's the right thing to do, you know, then I'm the tree hugger. If I talk to people about the risk, then we get further down the road. But I'm not advocating higher fuel prices, but it wouldn't hurt. Energy and water, part of the things that we do there are things like putting solar on a roof. We have a 1 megawatt unit going on the roof. I told earlier, the boiler that you're putting up out here, we're building one about 1/4 the size for one of our plants. That it's a natural gas boiler that we're putting together. So again, we're looking at renewables. We also, and I'll talk about another opportunity here in just a little bit, right here. So I mentioned care already. How do you get carpet back? Do you know, how many of you can tell me that you for sure bought Shaw carpet when you bought carpet in your house? Two. How many of you have carpet in your house? Point taken. Nobody knows. Quite frankly, there's only one key that you have right now, this year, unless you bought some just within the last 6 months, because we all have started marking much more. If you found a marking on the back of your carpet, it was ours. But very, very few people knew that. And the collectors, there are a whole bunch of collectors. There's about 65 in the country, mostly in major metropolitan areas, that collect carpet and sell it into whatever market. So some people are making automotive parts, some people are making resin that go into park benches and whatever. So but 60 of these companies, and quite frankly, most of them are mom and pop shops struggling to stay in business. So those folks really do, again, the circular economy is contingent on getting back. Dave Renard and I, working together when I was at Herman Miller, we tried to talk our respective companies into using prisons to take furniture apart. Because the infrastructure of getting furniture back, the one thing that's common in every metropolitan area is there's always a jail. And Dave and I thought, let's use that labor. That didn't work so well. They're still not doing that.
It was political reasons.
The business reasons, the state of Michigan loved it, right? We had a trial that they emptied all their warehouses of old furniture because in the state of Michigan, everybody buys new furniture. Nobody has old. Not so in Georgia, by the way. But we emptied those warehouses using prison labor, and it was great. And quite frankly, that, though, is still, when you talk to any industry, how do you get things back? Right now, do you know that the pop bottle, soda bottle, I forget where I'm at, the bottle industry is struggling, we're struggling to keep enough bottles in our factory. And you think, what? Everybody wants to recycle pop bottles and soda bottles and PET, not unless there's money in it. And that's the problem with that structure right there, is that nobody's willing to pay for that recycling. So we're trying to augment it. In fact, last year the carpet industry augmented those folks to the tune of about $6 or $7 million. That's just to keep them in business. It was a stopgap at best, because the price of oil has driven down the value of what they're collecting to the point where some of them have gone out of business. Some of them haven't even been able to stay. So that's the first problem with the circular. That is the biggest problem to saying that we're going to have a circular economy.
I've never heard a bad thing about Michigan's recycling policy when it comes to 10% refunding. It's awesome for your company. So why hasn't that caught on?
Because we'll get to that in a minute. Everybody. It's called EPR, Extended Producer Responsibility, and that is one of the topics I'll get through right here in just a minute. When we get carpet back, so I've already mentioned a couple things. When I first got a call about 12 years ago now, first time my position was created, I said no, it didn't go. The second time they called was about 6 years, almost 7 years ago. And the only person that knew that I was interviewing was in the back of the room. Julie had found it on one of my emails that I was interviewing, but she and I talked, so she knew I was looking. And one of the things that appealed to me about Shaw was that they had this big old, and I'm using those terms kindly, refinery. It was just like taking carpet as the crude oil and making it into brand new caprolactam. It was truly the golden halo of the circular economy. Take carpet, didn't care whose it was, as long as it was nylon, there's a device you can check it, brought it right back, made clear caprolactam, made brand new virgin nylon, as clean and as white as any virgin nylon. The problem was, it started breaking down. We had acquired it through when we acquired all of Honeywell's assets. We'd started a backup, and unfortunately, it was very abrasive on the equipment, and it got old and creaky and dangerous. Basically, you had a refinery that was needing $30 to $40 million of retrofit, and it would drive up the price of our nylon by a factor of two if we did it. Sustainability, couldn't do it. So we continue to look for that golden halo again. We currently still take back all of our commercial carpet, but residentially, we took a new facility. We have a new facility that we put about $20 million into that we're looking and researching, trying to figure out new homes for recycling of old carpet. It is just very difficult because of all that dirt that's in there with that latex, and everybody has done it for the same way for the last 35 years, literally 35 years. So what we do for that residential carpet that we do get back right now, we create energy. We have an energy center that we create steam for the world's largest carpet factory, the one that puts out a truckload of carpet, residential carpet, every 20 minutes. It's fueled with electrical and heat by recycled carpet, post-consumer carpet. So we're trying, we're not perfect, and that's the big thing here, is that you have to continue to try. So that's our circular economy model, and here's what, you know, that's what we've been trying to work on. EcoWorks Carpetal. We like it so well that we put our name on it and we put a 1-800 number. And so if you have Carpetal in your office, if you pick it up, ours will look different because we're the only one that really makes carpet without PVC. It was in 2001 we released EcoWorks Carpetal. The 1-800 number people call and we go and pick it up. So it's good news. The residential is the problem, it's not. Enter Extended Producer Responsibility. There is one state with a, if you will, bottle bill, and it was passed, and the industry actually still manages it. And with that management, we collect 25 cents for every yard of carpet that's sold in California, and it creates a fund of about $22 million. And what we do is we try to bridge the gap between the price of virgin and the price of taking carpet back and cleaning it up. And so there is $21 million into the economy of both California and states around it of people that have figured out that if they take polyester was a big issue, nobody was using it, and all of a sudden you put a bounty on 25 cents for every pound you use, and all of a sudden people in New Jersey want to buy it. And so the fiber from California gets shipped to New Jersey, so they get the 25 cents. That's how EPR bill works. And I will tell you that every industry is against it because it adds such complexity and mandatory issues. And right now, we have seen a growth in recycled rates,
But the state of California has a rate that they want recycling at 75%. The state legislature said, well, the CalRecycle, you have a goal of 50% and you're not meeting that goal. So now we're going to pass a law that recycling rate in California has to be 75%. It's like, if you can't make 50, how are you going to make, you know, 75? They don't match, and that's the problem. If we can ever get where the bottle bill, for an example, matches, and I'll go to that side on California just to show how it can work really effectively. In fact, capture efficiency in California for bottles is 110%. You know that 10 cents that we pay here in Michigan helped me start the Hudsonville soccer team because we collected pop cans and took them back and it was great, right? Well, the people in Nevada and Oregon and Washington State and all the states around it are shipping truckloads into California. And that system is failing as well, because if you make it too good, if we pay out too much for the carpet fiber, you generate more demand than what you're going to have funds to deal with. And as the treasurer of CARE, that is a hard thing to manage. And that's the thing that I've been playing with the last basically 4 years that I was named treasurer, and I've been doing it ever since. People thought that they could trust me with their wallet, so they gave me that bill. Warren's? I'm not going to say anything about Warren up here. Yeah. No, Warren is a great advocate, actually, of the environment. I do have to say that. He has allowed me to start a sustainability forum, much like what you have right here for all the companies of Berkshire Hathaway. And the first one I called in Atlanta 4 years ago, it was like, talk about nervous when you're waiting for that thing to happen, when you have Geico, Fruit of the Loom, you know, Benjamin Moore, Burlington Northern Railroad, NetJets. What do we have in common? We got together and we found we all had a lot in common, just like all of you here have, right? It doesn't matter the industry. You worry about energy, you worry about people, you worry about all those things. So we're going into our fifth year. And the Warren Buffett story there, though, is that not so much Warren, but just their organization. You know how many people are employed by Berkshire Hathaway? Realize their shares right now, their A shares go for $250,000 a share. He has 28 employees. 28 employees. And so, you know, I'm trying to get this started. My CFO goes, you can do this, but you have to go through Mark Hamburg, who's the CFO of all of Berkshire. So I thought, oh, this will be fun. So I got the phone number and gave it, and I called it thinking, I'm going to get a secretary. Mark Hamburg answers, and he allowed us to do it. But, you know, it's a small organization for being, I don't know, I forget the number of billions of dollars they're worth. But onward, just a couple quick things here. Cradle to cradle, most of you probably know this, but cradle to cradle, you really worry about material realization. There we go. Material realization. So are you recycling renewable energy, water stewardship, social fairness, and material health? 15 minutes? Yeah, that'll be fine. And those five tenets, it's just good business. And quite frankly, then getting the products and the first four things, that's really about your company. This is the toughest one for any product: material health, transparency, what's in the material. And that one is what Bill McDonough came to first design text with the fabric, and then he brought that principle over, and Gabe Wing and Scott Sharon and the team at Herman Miller created the protocol working with Bill to include all five tenets. He really brought material health to all of us. That was the big add that he brought, and he continues to talk about and take it forward. And like I said, we're doing it because we believe it is the right thing to do for risk mitigation, making sure that our products have the good chemistry. Don't use PVC if you can get away from it. So that's what we're really trying to do. Again, these are just the same five tenets in case you couldn't read the first one. But we really do work on all five. And on material health, it's the most work that we do, because you go down to 100 parts per million. So 99.99%, you have to know all the way down there. You can only do it with your suppliers. Therein lies why you have a sustainability purchasing agreement, so that everybody knows that they're going to have to give you their information. You're going to have to get that information, keep it secret. You can't give it out, or you're in big trouble. So that is probably the biggest difference between the standards. Whoops, I'm going the wrong way. And then you get a scorecard. This is for our EcoWorks tile. Notice that we, social fairness, we're way up here with Make It Right and giving flooring to the people in Katrina that particular year. St. Jude we give to on a regular basis. So we're doing well in social fairness. And material health was silver, so then you're only silver. Transparency. With 15 minutes, I'm going a little bit quick, but I'll be around afterwards. Transparency, how many of you have seen that label? How many of you understood what it said? How many of you would say dihydrogen oxide, good or bad? Good. Bad. Dihydrogen oxide, better known as water. Any water. You know, it's just another way to name it. You know, you read a cereal box, do you really know what vitamin A is? Yes, you kind of have an idea of its impact, but you don't know what it is. But more and more people are asking for this kind of label on our products. And our industry, carpet, is being one of the first targeted. We are getting asked probably even more, and talking to Gabe and others on the furniture side, even within the commercial space, we're being asked, what's in it? We want to know what's in it. We want to know the health hazards that are in it. So you give them a label of some sort. Well, that's great, but if, how many of you have black on? Okay, black. It's called carbon black. It's cancerous. Did you know that? But it's not, because you're not going to breathe carbon black. It's embedded in the fabric. That's just one example. So it's really about what, well, I'll get there, jumping ahead. Declare and HPD. Those two assessments in our industry are starting to really take hold. Declare is something that Mohawk really is behind, and we provide, because our customer does it, or our competitor does it, we end up doing as well, give a list of the chemicals. But really, with that list of chemicals, can people really understand what they are, even with the hazards? HPD, it's the same thing. The HPD is a little bit more rigorous than the Declare label. So the next step then is determining the actual risk, right? What is the risk? Like, water poisoning is real. What's the risk of drinking water and getting water poisoning? Not much. But if you're super dehydrated and you drink 10 gallons of it, it could kill you. So that would be the hazard is there, but the risk is low, right? Green screen and cradle to cradle actually do that risk assessment as well in their assessment of the chemistry. That's why we like it, because it gives us more information. We feel better about it, the products that we're producing, because we know that we're not, if there is something in there that's a hazardous, we know that it isn't a problem, like carbon black. Memory foam, right? It's got isocyanate in it. Any foam products, basically, most of them are made with isocyanate. And if it's there, it's a problem, but it could be risked out. If there's no free monomer left, you're in pretty good shape. Same thing with glass, silica. Actually, there's another one that people use, is that sand. How many of you have been on the beach in California? I love California right now, by the way. Have you ever, when you would go from the street to the beach, ever seen a sign at the lifeguard station that says, caution, entering at your own risk because this beach might cause cancer? It's because the silica and the sand. Now, if you breathe sand, you might get cancer. If you breathe sand, you're probably dead and buried. You know, it's not, people are not going to breathe that much sand. So again, hazard, it's there, the silica is there. The risk is quite low. Same thing with silica. This is in a glass manufacturing facility picture. I wouldn't want to be that guy without that mask. That silica is highly carcinogenic at that point. But when it's in glass, is it really? No. It's still there. The silica is there, but the risk is very, very low. So then you do the final thing that cradle to cradle really requires is optimization. In the last year, we've taken out coal fly ash from our carpet. It's still tested way low enough in the mercury and on all those things because we were buying really high-end coal from where we're buying this coal, fly ash. But we went to calcium carbonate just because we could. It made sense. There was another defoamer in our latex, and it was a banned material, we found out. It was totally a surprise to us. We had to change all of our industry. We went to our adhesive manufacturer that had this defoamer in it, and we said, we want this out. He said, oh yeah, no problem. We're giving you that formula in China anyway. And by the way, we're going to change everybody in West or Northwest Georgia to that particular latex. We're all using the same latex, right? So optimization can result in some really IP as well. An optimization of the mirror chair, for an example, was another one where Herm Miller ended up with IP by optimization. So cradle to cradle. Oh, and these are just real quick. This is what an HPD looks like. So lots of information, list of chemicals, and is there a hazard with them? Declare, these are the chemicals. So this is their proprietary list of chemicals. Now there's some on there that it's classes of chemicals. So PVC, the whole chlorinated hydrocarbons are kind of a class that they will look at very, very carefully. And that's what a declare label looks like. And that's at 100 parts per million. Now here's the problem. I want to show you with you one story. You know, sometimes you get these burrs under your saddle. And this was a burr under my saddle for about a year. Have a competitor doing declare labels. They have a product almost exactly like ours, to the point we know it's exactly like ours. I'll leave it there. And there was some back and forth between the companies. That's why we know it's very similar. Their declare label, and they claim it to be declare free, is that free of all chemicals. They had 23 chemicals. Our declare label had 47. Exact same product. It's self-certification. They do it themselves. So if you're going to look at any of this, make sure you look for ones that are saying this is third-party certified, that it's the right information. Again, inventory screen, assess, and optimize. This is the four stages. Cradle to cradle, HPD, and declare. You can see that cradle to cradle is much more robust. It's the whole company, but then it's also the product on the material health. HPD, you inventory and screen. You just basically say, here are the chemicals, here's their hazard. Same thing with declare. So guess which one makes your life really easy, but yet really hard? It's called cradle to cradle. It's hard to do, but once you have it, the other two are super easy. So it was very easy for us to move into that realm. Finally, in the form of transparency, somebody mentioned the sustainability report here at Hope College just a few minutes ago. We have an annual report. Please go online, look it up. I look younger in that picture, so magic photography, right? But you know, it really is. And here's the type of company that I love working for. Is the first year I got there, they said, here, do the next annual report. We're now on our ninth, I think. And so they'd already done two or three. And the CFO called me up and said, Paul, can you come on over? I said, sure, go over and talk to Ken Jackson, his name. He said, Paul, we're going to third party certify it this year. We're going to get it assured. And I said, really? Because I knew what that cost. Because we had passed on it a couple times before in my career. And he said, yes, because if we're going to tell people we're doing something, I want to make sure it's accurate and it's defensible and we can actually point to it and say, go there, check us out. So go there, check us out. Last slide. Kind of a gaudy logo. It looks a little better now after it's been cleaned up. When I went to my records, this is the one I found. Well, I leave here and I go down to Dalton, Georgia, and I get invited to a meeting. And what it was is it's called the IMCP, the Integrated Manufacturing Partnership Consortium. And what it is, there are 11 of them around the United States right now, communities that were granted a special designation to get super easy access to funds from the federal government. So every department, like the Department of Commerce, there's a bunch of money set aside. Department of the Environment, a bunch of money set aside, just waiting for these 11 communities to ask for it in the form of grants.
And I got to the second meeting. The first meeting would happen before I got there. The second meeting, they called me, and I go in, and we're sitting around a table, and there's three professors from the local Dalton State University, which is about the size of Hope, about 3,000, 3,500 students. So three or four professors and a couple people from the community, and they said, and here's what we want to do for the environment. And I said, really? How do you know that we need four professors, one endowed fellowship for sustainability in a community? Do you know what sustainability is? And he was the dean of the business school, and he goes, no. So how can you ask for professors if you don't know even the definition of sustainability? And they said, well, what would you do, Paul? And I said, well, you know, there's this little organization up in Michigan. It's called the West Michigan Environmental Action Council that funded the Sustainable Business Forum. And the Sustainable Business Forum is exactly what we need. And they said, really? Tell us more. And about 2 months later, Bill Stahl came into town. We kicked off the Alliance for Innovation and Sustainability in Northwest Georgia. So we are an offshoot of you. So thank you. It was great to see what you're doing. Hopefully we can do some great things too. At this point, we've gone after two different grants. One of them is for a college professor, and one of them is for coaches for STEM education in middle schools. Bringing them, taking, you know, basically guidance counselors, but don't give them the normal guidance counseling, and we're waiting to hear whether we're going to make that grant money. But it's definitely an offshoot of this organization, so thank you very much for that incentive and, you know, inspiration, and I really appreciate the time today. I'll take any questions if we've got any time at all, or, oh, I'm right at, that's as close as I think I've ever come to the right time.
I think we can make time for a couple questions if anybody has to sneak out, we understand, but yeah. Do we have some questions?
Yeah, hey, Tom. I think there are some, and I think it will be a disaster going forward if they actually start backing away. But I think there's a lot. When you look at COP21 and the carbon efforts that are going on through the UN, I think international, anybody that's in an international company has to pay attention, which we are. We're over in China manufacturing, selling all over the world. So I don't sense it in my company, and we are really conservative. I mean, you think West Michigan's conservative, but we are really conservative down there as well. And it's almost inspirational to find that all the CEOs aren't bailing on this effort. I think they see it as a business imperative. I will tell you that when I got there, I thought one of the first things I was going to have to do is set up, you know, the whole recycling and all those efforts. That's good business. I don't think people are going to bail on good business. Yeah. Yeah.
So I was one of those shoppers that went into a local carpet store to put carpet in our home and was asking these questions. And the poor woman was looking at me like, what are you asking me? But she really helped me get the information, and we did look for cradle to cradle. But which is better? Because I was presented with either buy the carpet made from recycled plastic bottles, but this cannot be recycled, or buy this carpet, which ultimately can then be recycled.
Can I tape you and take you home? On our polyester, and she evidently was talking to somebody probably Johnson & Johnson or one of those that has some Shaw carpet. Our nylons are cradle cradle certified. That was the easy part. We blew it because we'd already done our commercial carpet, which is all nylon. So moving it to residential, we did that very quickly after I got there. We did wood very quickly. Those were things that were just trunked them out. Polyester is a problem in that we had to get over this almost fear that somebody would hear cradle-cradle bronze instead of cradle-cradle silver. Polyester has antimony. It is a red material. It's not carcinogenic, mutagenic, or any of that stuff, but it is a red material. And antimony is in all polyester. So that's what's going to be released. We are going to release our polyester is complete, and we're just waiting for the right time to send the news release out. So then you won't have that. You'll be able to get polyester cradle cradle certified from us as well as our nylon carpet. So, great question. Bob.
So Just a point of information, Warren Buffett does play a ukulele made from sustainably grown.
He does. Very good. There was a meeting about a year ago, I guess. He came to our management conference, and we all knew he was going to be there, so they let us turn in questions and stuff. And they said one of the questions that was selected to ask Warren up on stage, so our CEO is asking Warren these questions, and he goes, so the question, Warren, that came in is, so why did you buy some IBM? For the first time ever, Warren Buffett bought a tech stock, because this is about 3 years ago, I guess it was. Just this past year, he was at another conference. But anyway, 3 years ago. And his answer just kind of blew my mind. He says, well, you know, he's sitting up there with his Coke right next to him because he owns 10% of Coke. And he says, you know, I've been reading IBM's annual report for about 15 years, and I found something I really like this year, so I bought $10 billion worth. It's like, take out my billfold and, you know, just buy it. He does things in scale. And, you know, the interesting thing is I've been there 6 years. They've asked for money twice. They never ask for us to give them anything back. They leave us alone, let us manage our business. We are in charge of building the worth of the company, and it's very clear. If we don't build the worth of the company, then he'll come and see us. But as long as you do things ethically, and that was the last conference, and the last really meaningful thing, somebody that's 80 plus years old, he said, I can accept a business failure of an effort. I can't accept ethics violations. You violate my ethics and your ethics, you will be gone. I thought, wow, what a powerful statement from somebody that is that influential in so many people. I mean, he has 390,000 employees that report to him. So, I mean, if that 390,000 people believe, do the right thing, be ethical, and it's a fun place to work. I think I'm going to get the hook. Thanks.
Well, I'm sure that you all can join me in saying how much we appreciate Paul making the trip back to a place that he is near and dear to our hearts here as a part of creating the Sustainable Business Forum and the sustainability movement in West Michigan. So we very much appreciate your time and your experiences that you've shared. So Dan, let me know. We have kind of a unique speaker gift for you, which I'm excited to share the information, so I don't want to get it incorrect. But this is a pen that is made from reclaimed wood from the former Newcraft factory in Grand Rapids, and the wood that the pen is made from is actually from a tree that predates the Declaration of Independence. So, thank you. This is a token of our appreciation for you being here today. So just a couple closing comments, and then I think maybe if Paul or others will be around after, if you wanted to come up and didn't have an opportunity to ask a question. Our next meeting, as we indicated, is the May membership meeting, which will be on green cleaning at West Michigan Works on Monday, May 8th. And also want to remind you, please turn in your name tag. Dan has started to help make sure, because it's hard. You want to walk out and forget that you have it on, and we're trying to reuse them, that we have a nice gift drawing that somebody will be drawn if you make sure that you return your name tag. So other than that, I do want to just take a chance, because it's early to mid-April, which is one of my favorite months, because this is the month of Earth Day. And in my world, in my professional world, it's become Earth Month and all things going on that we have. So keep an eye on the Sustainable Business Forum newsletter, because I know that Dan's doing a great job about putting some events that are going on at some of our peer organizations and some of your organizations. And I've seen some great things happening. We have some fun things at Spartan Nash. I hope that you check out our programs as well as some of the others. So with that, enjoy the rest of your afternoon, and we hope to see you in May.